Shoti. Here I must retrace my steps a bit to the 2nd March and recall a wonderful interview with Shoti. We had been taking coffee with him the previous 2 mornings, and that day we had a session which I don't think B, Lemony, and I will easily forget. All that he said was spoken as his own personal reactions and opinions, but their application was so general as to be worth setting down whilst still fresh in the mind. So I will write them as they occur to me, not necessarily in the order in which they came. He spoke of his personal and very special relationship with his own master and grandfather, saying it was one of great frankness and spontaneity. He said he used to disagree vehemently with him sometimes. He was not afraid to ask for anything he wanted, having an absolute childlike faith that he would get it, and being quite prepared to pay the price for having it. And it seemed invariably to come to pass. During the time he was an officer in the army, if he wanted to visit Beas, he would ask the master's permission, and if he said yes, come rain or shine, he would take leave. He seems to radiate this faith and act on it without hesitation or fear. Decide, he says, in your own mind clearly what you must do, and if you have full faith in its veracity, it will undoubtedly come to pass. He stressed very strongly, however, that this was his personal approach, and he could not guarantee its success in the case of other people. Not everyone is capable of Shoti's degree of faith. He told a story in this connection of a hermit who lived across the river from a village and who relied for his food on a man's bringing it every day from the village. One day, after the monsoon broke, the man said to the hermit, "Every day I find it increasingly difficult to bring your food. If it should rain heavily tonight, although I would dearly like to come and will do my best, I may not be able to cross the river tomorrow." The hermit told him to have no fear, that all would go well. The next day, and for many subsequent days, he continued to deliver the food, in spite of the river being in full spate, to the amazement of his fellow villagers. When they exclaimed at his ability to continue his mission, and asked him how he managed to do so, as the river was now impassable, he said, "Well, I don't know how it occurs, but the hermit told me I would be able to bring him his food, so I just obeyed him and went straight over to him." The village priest, keeping watch on him, saw that he walked over on the water, realizing that through this miracle there might arise the possibility of his losing his flock to the hermit. He said to himself, "Where one has gone safely, another may follow." And he too attempted the crossing. "But," said Shoti, "he took the precaution of tying a rope around his waist to make doubly sure of himself, and lack of faith was his undoing, for he was swept away and drowned." He told us how he had courted his colonel's displeasure by refusing to eat meat in the mess, and subsequently obtained an unheard-of dispensation from attending mess 7 nights a week, and how, in spite of all rules being to the contrary, he obtained leave, whilst on training for active service in Burma, for the present master's wedding. On one occasion he had a very remarkable escape from death. He was the railway transport officer at a certain station during a troubled time, when a fracas broke out, a Muslim troublemaker suddenly going berserk, shooting indiscriminately and killing 1 or 2 people before anything could be done to stop him. Somebody warned Shoti, who ran unarmed to deprive the man of his rifle. The latter fired at him and missed, killing somebody behind Shoti, and fired again at point-blank range, taking off the top of Shoti's thumb. Shoti said he stood in front of the man, strangely certain that he could not be killed. The man next charged Shoti with a bayonet fixed in his rifle, which Shoti managed to deflect at the last moment. It passed through his jacket, scratching him and drawing a little blood. At the same time, someone else shot the man from the side with a revolver. A friend took Shoti out of the station and ran him straight to the hospital. A rumor followed that he had been killed, and his colonel was actually posting him as dead, when the general, who had received the true report, intercepted the message. Already the rumor had reached his grandfather at Beas, but Bure Maharaji would not believe it. That evening, Shoti took leave from the hospital and went to Beas, which was not far away, and was able to give the lie to the rumor. The highlight of the whole conversation for all of us came about thus. B said, "Sometimes the master seems to do things that some of us find inexplicable. Could you tell us why this should be?" Shoti said, "That does happen. Sometimes he seems to act in a way that you think is entirely wrong, and perhaps your opinion is shared by others, and on occasions all the satsangis present think it wrong, and say so." Then Maharaji explains and convinces them that what had seemed wrong to them was really the only feasible solution because, as becomes apparent later, he could see the full implication of the whole problem and had foreseen on another plane that which they could not possibly know. Then he made a very memorable remark. "When we see flaws in a master, it is because he is a mirror. When we look at him, we cannot, with our limited vision, comprehend his masterhood. All we see is a reflection of our incompleteness." This makes me feel that it could be used as a very good yardstick of one's own progress, or rather, lack of progress. Regarding doubts which spring up in the mind at such times, he said, "Before you are initiated, you have every right to question and criticize the master and Sant Mat. But after initiation, it is necessary for progress that you have complete faith in the master, and faith that he acts as he does because he has an overall understanding of the whole problem, and you have only a limited vision." Then again, he stressed that what is said to suit the progress of one person cannot be applied to another. The whole relationship is an extremely personal one between master and disciple. There is no room for jealousy, because what he does for A at the time he does it is not applicable to B at that moment of time. And, as neither A nor B are in a position to judge their relative heights, they cannot then judge what they do or do not merit from Maharaji, and they should therefore take what he gives absolutely without questioning it. Maharaji's relationship with each disciple, based on each one's individual angle of development, makes complete nonsense of jealousy. Another significant fact, he told us, was that although general rules are laid down on our conduct in Sant Mat, after a soul has reached a certain height, the master may break his own rule in relation to that particular person. As an instance of this, he quoted Shoti, who had been in charge of all the machinery at the Dara in Bure Maharaji's time. Shoti said, "All this time spent in Bhajan trying to reach the master. If you have true love for the master, you shut your eyes, and in 2 minutes you are in Satsang." Shoti had already told us how indulgent Hazur Maharaji was to him in his requests for leave of absence from his army unit for Dara functions. When Bure Maharaji passed away and Sardar Bahadur succeeded him, Shoti asked him if he could expect the same indulgences, and Sardar Bahadur said, "No, for he was a king, and I am a beggar." Shoti also said, "Everyone, without exception, is a very nice person all the time, if we use the right, the most loving line of approach." "Nothing can stand against love," said Lemony. "Love is an emotion on this plane. Hate is an emotion. Anyone capable of a great hate is also capable of a great love. One thought here of St. Paul's dislike of Christ, which turned to love in a single moment. It is only the indifferent ones who are difficult to reach because of their lack of reaction. He said when Baba Jaimal Singh told Bure Maharaji of his decision to make him his successor, Maharaj Sawan Singh said, "I cannot at the same time look after the Sangat and my family properly. I will take on your Sangat if you will take care of my family." So in family matters, he always referred problems to Baba Jaimal Singh. One of us asked Shoti, "Would you ever want to be born again?" He replied, "No, never. I could go tomorrow and have no regrets. Everything I do thoroughly and well, but without a sense of attachment." I only wish the atmosphere of this talk and Shoti's charm and radiant, assured, and yet childlike simplicity could be reproduced. He really made one experience complete confidence and humility at the same moment.